Video, please.
It was really cold that day.
This is May 21st, 2009, over a year and a half before the game ships. As you can see, the original map doesn't look anything like the one you know today. The map features two buildings with a path in between them, but it was really failing to give you that sense of place. When you exited one building, you didn't really have much of a sense of orientation. However, the most driving design element, the element of danger from being on top of a mountain, was persistent from day one to ship. Now, fast forwarding to September 28th, 2009, more than a year before the game is released, and you'll see the map in a state that we call lockout complete. And what this means is that the map structure is locked in place, and the design won't radically change. However, even at this phase, there are entire areas of playable space that don't yet exist, because we haven't discovered a reason for them. Now, in a second, we're going to pan over and we're going to see the old map off in the vista, and it's there so that the designer can still draw influence from it, but what you don't see are any details yet. And what you do see are called case textures. Now, case textures are basically placeholder colors the designers can use to block things out, and then work with the art department to figure out what they actually are. March 15th, 2010, 6 months before the game comes out, this is what we call the detail phase. This is the phase where designers start applying textures to the world. Now, designers don't typically aren't responsible for creating textures or models, but they are responsible for placing them in their world. And it's for this reason that I think Call of Duty level designers are three-part designer, one-part artist, one-part architect, and completely insane. The final phase in a map's life cycle is called the polish phase. Now, even in this late stage, you'll see some new things like this flanking path and the jump puzzle and overwatch position here in the center room. But what this phase is really all about is making the map as beautiful as possible without sacrificing gameplay or performance. And I think that this is one of the most challenging balancing acts that we do.
All right, everybody, now it's time to play Name That Map. So I want you to take a good look at this map list. This is a complete map of every... This is a complete list of every map we shipped in the game, including all the DLC. I'll give you a moment to wrap your mind around the staggering amount of game content that resulted in the death of four of our level designers. All right, so does anybody know what this map is? Alright, I heard some Havanas. You're all wrong, sorry. The actual name of this map is MP Cairo. MP Cairo is one of the first maps we started working on. Originally we thought that Call of Duty was going to be going to Egypt. This map was full of temples, pyramids, and I think a drivable camel at one point. But then something unfortunate happened. The environment was cut from the game. We know Black Ops is no longer going to be going to Egypt. This left us with this awesome map that we really love playing and no place to put it in. Fortunately for us, as painful as it is to have an entire environment be cut from the game, we were able to move this map to Cuba. Through the ingenuity and patience of you can redevelop the entire map into a new location. And I promise you, and Phil would want me to give this impression that reskinning a map is something you can do at the push of a button. Detailing the map to make it seem like an actual place is something like 80% of the total work to require to make the map.
All right, so next up, what map is this?
Nuketown.
Say that again? I can't hear you guys, can you go a little louder? All right, you're all wrong. This map's called MP Nuke, actually. Nuketown was a map that came out by accident. What happened was David Vonderhaar here was watching a movie, I think it was Indiana Jones and the Crystal Skull, one night, and he came in the next day, he was all inspired and agitated and excited. He's like, oh my god, I'm going to do this fucking map, it's so cool. And in typical fashion, we all kind of ignored him. And what happened at that point was we started watching some footage. We actually did like the idea of the map. There was a bunch of footage of nuclear test sites in Nevada. We're watching these towns just get blown to smithereens. And it was pretty inspiring. So after hearing Vaughn's inspirational speech that morning, Adam Hoggett, one of our level designers, actually, Rex, can you stand up?
Yeah, Adam fucking Hoggett!
All right, there's the rock star right there, responsible for Nuketown. So if you hate the map, you can punch him on the way out. So Adam basically took the map idea, riffed on it, and had the map up and running in 2 days. Without permission, I might add. This is not an official ask to make this map. But he did it anyway. It was pretty cool. So within 2 days, we had this map up and running. Everybody loved it. It was an instant favorite within the team. So Nuketown became a symbol for us of exploring creativity. So a little story about the development of Nuketown. The random spawn mannequins and the underground nuke sequence were what effectively led us down the path of map interactivity with things like closable doors, zip lines, and spaceships taking off in the middle of the map. The point here is that ideas generate other ideas, and sometimes you have to let somebody not do what they're supposed to do because it leads you somewhere else.
All right, this map?